Welcome back! My name is ballerscuba. This is Video Games Over Time. We are still in 1982. Today, we're going to take a closer look at The Hobbit. We talked a bit about The Hobbit in our last video about J.R.R. Tolkien. Tolkien, of course, wrote The Hobbit. As mentioned before, The Hobbit was Tolkien's first novel, published in 1937. Tolkien had published several pieces of poetry previously, and had been working in private on the creation of several languages and a mythology for future stories. The creation of The Hobbit began in the early 1930s. Tolkien was working as Rawlinson and Bosworth Professor of Anglo-Saxon at Oxford University, with a fellowship at Pembroke College at the time. While marking school certificate papers, Tolkien was struck by inspiration and, grabbing a blank sheet of paper, wrote, "In a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit." These words would become the iconic first line of The Hobbit. By late 1932, Tolkien had completed the manuscript. He gave the manuscript to several of his friends. One of those friends would be C.S. Lewis, a member of a small writing group known as the Inklings, and Tolkien's then student, Elaine Griffiths. In 1936, Elaine Griffiths was visited by Susan Dagnow, a staff member of the publishing company George Allen and Unwin. Griffiths lent Dagnow the manuscript for The Hobbit. Dagnow then gave the manuscript to her boss, Stanley Unwin. Stanley then gave the manuscript to his son, Rayner. Rayner liked the manuscript, and so George Allen and Unwin agreed to publish the novel. Tolkien has cited William Morris as a major influence on his writing style. William Morris was a prolific fantasy writer who lived from 1834 to 1896. His most famous works were News from Nowhere and The Well at the World's End. Tolkien was also inspired by Samuel Rutherford Crockett's historical novel, The Black Douglas. Crockett's style and several events from the novel would inspire Tolkien's work. Tolkien's use of goblins was influenced by George MacDonald's The Princess and the Goblin. It is said that MacDonald's work helped Tolkien frame the use of fantasy within his Catholic faith. Tolkien was also inspired by mythology, in particular by Norse mythology. The poetic Edda and prose Edda in particular had a heavy influence on The Hobbit, even providing several of the characters' names in the novel, especially the dwarves. Although the Norse epic tales may have provided the names of the dwarves themselves are much more reminiscent of the fairy tales collected by the Brothers Grimm. Tolkien was also inspired by Beowulf, and much of his world is inspired by the world found in Beowulf. From the customs to the runes to some of the phrases used by the characters, the influence of Beowulf can be seen throughout Tolkien's world. Tolkien also based his depiction of the dwarves on medieval texts about Jewish people in Europe. While Tolkien denied using the dwarves as an allegory for the Jewish people, and always expressed respect and admiration for Jewish culture and the people's struggles, the similarities between Tolkien's dwarves and stories of Jewish people has become slightly controversial in recent years. Tolkien would supply maps and illustrations to go with the book. The publisher would be impressed with these and included them with the publication instead of hiring an artist to draw what Tolkien described. Tolkien, in fact, created the original dust jacket for the book as well. The Hobbit was originally published by George Allen and Unwin in the United Kingdom in 1937. The critics were almost unanimously positive about the novel. After the initial publication of The Hobbit, Tolkien continued to work on his mythology, and decided to integrate The Hobbit into the existing mythology. As a result, there were some changes made to the initial story. Those would result in a second edition released in 1951, and a third edition released in 1966. While the later publication of The Lord of the Rings did see a dip in the critics' view of The Hobbit, the view of The Hobbit has been almost completely positive as time has gone on. It is beloved by both readers and by critics, often making best books of all time lists, especially lists focused on children's literature. That is the backstory to The Hobbit. With that now told, it's time to talk about the plot of the novel. If you have not read The Hobbit and do not want its plot spoiled, now would be the time to stop watching. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video. For those that have stayed, let's talk about the plot of The Hobbit. The novel opens in Bag End, the home of Bilbo Baggins, a fine, upstanding hobbit. Gandalf, a wizard, meets Bilbo there and tricks Bilbo into hosting a party for a group of dwarves. Those dwarves, led by Thorin Oakenshield, were Dwalin, Balin, Kili, Fili, Dori, Nori, Ori, Oin, Gloin, Biffer, Boffer, and Bomber. The dwarves sing about reclaiming the Lonely Mountain from the dragon Smaug, getting both the kingdom and their treasure back. Gandalf shows everyone a map of the Lonely Mountain, revealing a secret door that leads into the mountain. Thorin has the key to this door, so the prospect of reclaiming Lonely Mountain now seems possible. Gandalf then suggests that Bilbo should join the dwarves as a burglar. The idea is initially rejected, but Bilbo, despite his hesitation, agrees and signs a contract. The party leaves the following morning, leaving Bag End behind. During their travels, Gandalf mysteriously disappears. The rest of the party goes into the wilderness where they encounter a group of trolls. The trolls are able to snatch all the dwarves, but Gandalf returns and is able to trick the trolls and keep them outside until dawn. The sun turns the trolls to stone, and the party is able to escape. In a nearby cave, the party finds weapons and armor. Bilbo gets an elvish short sword that glows blue when evil is nearby. The party then heads to the edge of the wild, where elves are ready to meet them. They travel to Rivendell to meet the elf chief Elrond. Elrond is able to find and read a hidden message on the map, which gives clues to the dwarves on how to find and enter the secret door. The group then heads up through the Misty Mountains, but a storm forces them into shelter. While in a cave, the party is kidnapped by a group of goblins, except for Gandalf, who manages to escape. The goblins bring the party to the Great Goblin, who demands to know why the dwarves are there. After discovering the elvish swords, though, the goblins and the dwarves fight. Gandalf returns, kills the Great Goblin, and tries to lead the group out of the mountain. Bilbo, however, falls deeper into the mountain and is separated from the dwarves. Bilbo finds himself in the dark, but is able to find a ring, which he puts into his pocket. After some stumbling around, Bilbo encounters Gollum, a strange creature who lives in the cave. Gollum seems interested in eating Bilbo, so Bilbo draws his sword. Gollum then proposes a game of riddles. If Gollum wins, he will eat Bilbo. If Bilbo wins, Gollum will show him the way out of the mountain. Bilbo accepts. After a few riddles, Bilbo struggles to think of a riddle and asks Gollum what he thinks Bilbo has in his pocket, which is the ring. Gollum cannot guess the answer. In the original version of the story, Gollum leads Bilbo out and the two part as friends. Starting with the second edition, though, Gollum is quite upset at the loss of his ring and tries to break the agreement. Bilbo, however, had put on the ring while playing with it in his pocket. The ring makes Bilbo invisible, so Gollum cannot see him. Gollum assumes that Bilbo left, so inadvertently shows Bilbo the way out of the mountain, and Bilbo is able to escape Gollum and the goblins. Bilbo meets the rest of the party outside of the mountains and tells them about his adventure under the mountain, but leaves out the part about the ring. The party then leaves, hoping to make the most of the sunlight before the goblins come after them. After dusk, the goblins catch up to the party, riding wolf-like wargs. The party climbs trees to try to escape the goblins, but the goblins light the trees on fire. Luckily, the Lord of the Eagles sees the trouble the party is in. He and a few other eagles come down to save the party, carrying them away to a safer spot. After resting, Gandalf tells the party that he must leave again, but that he can lead them to the house of Beorn. Beorn is a shapeshifter who can transform from a human to a large black bear. Gandalf leads the dwarves, a few at a time, into Bjorn's house so as to not startle Bjorn. Because Bjorn hates goblins, he is friendly to the dwarves, and Bjorn and Gandalf give advice to the dwarves on how to proceed to Lonely Mountain through Mirkwood Forest. The party then sets out into the darkness of Mirkwood Forest. After a few days, the party arrives at a stream, which they were warned not to touch. However, Bomber falls in and goes into a deep sleep. The rest of the party is forced to carry him. One night, the party sees a flicker of lights. Going against warnings, the dwarves head to the lights and find elves feasting. However, as soon as the dwarves show, the elves turn off the lights and flee. This happens two more times until the dwarves and Bilbo become lost and separated from each other in the dark. Bilbo then falls asleep against a tree. When he wakes up, Bilbo is caught in a spider's trap. Bilbo takes out his sword and kills the spider. He then names his sword Sting. He slips on the ring, turning invisible, then heads out in search of the dwarves. He finds them caught by more spiders, so he cuts them out and the party fights against the spiders. Just when it seems the party will lose, the spiders flee. Wood elves come and capture the dwarves. Bilbo, who kept the ring on, was able to avoid the elves. The dwarves are thrown into the dungeon and Bilbo is able to sneak along. Bilbo then comes up with a plan to rescue the dwarves from the elf kingdom. Bilbo sneaks the dwarves to the wine cellar and puts them into barrels. Those barrels are then thrown into a river and Bilbo rides on top. The barrels arrive at Lake Town in the shadow of the Lonely Mountain, a human settlement. The humans pull the barrels to the side of the river and Bilbo frees the dwarves when no one is watching. All the dwarves have survived the journey. Thorin then leads the dwarves to the town hall and declares to the master of Lake Town that he is a descendant of the king under the mountain and that he has come to claim his inheritance. The people of Lake Town rejoice, hoping the dwarves can defeat Smaug. After resting and getting supplies, the dwarves head up the river toward the mountain. Deciding the main entrance is too dangerous, Bilbo and a few dwarves search for the hidden entrance, finding it after several hours. However, they cannot find a way to open the passage. After several days, Bilbo remembers the clue given to them by Elrond. They wait until sunset on the specified day and a keyhole reveals itself. Thorin quickly puts the key inside and they are able to open the door. Thorin then tells Bilbo to go through the passage in order to see what it is like inside. Bilbo goes into the passage and slips on the ring to become invisible. Inside, he finds Smaug sleeping on a huge pile of treasure. Bilbo takes a single golden cup and heads back to the dwarves. However, Smaug notices that the cup is missing and rampages around the mountain. The dwarves take cover inside the secret passage. After some time, Smaug returns back to his treasure. Bilbo puts the ring back on and returns to the dragon's lair, but Smaug is waiting for him this time. Smaug and Bilbo talk to each other, taunting each other until Smaug raises himself up and Bilbo is able to find a single weak spot in Smaug's scales. Bilbo rushes out of the lair back to the dwarves and tells them what he was able to find, but Smaug is enraged. Smaug rampages around the mountain again, causing an avalanche that traps the dwarves in the passage. Smaug, figuring out from talking to Bilbo that the men of Lake Town were involved in what has happened, flies to Lake Town to get his revenge. While Smaug is gone, the dwarves and Bilbo go inside the mountain and revel in the dragon's hoard. Bilbo finds the legendary gem, the Arkenstone, and keeps it for himself as a reward he felt he was promised. Bilbo also finds a mithril coat of mail, which he puts on. The party then leaves the mountain to a nearby outpost for food and rest, wondering what happened to Smaug. We then find out that Smaug had tried to destroy Lake Town. The men of Lake Town tried to fight back, but could not penetrate Smaug's armor. Bard, the captain of the archers, readies his last arrow when a thrush lands on his shoulder. The thrush, who had heard Bilbo tell the dwarves about Smaug's weakness, tells Bard about the weak spot. Bard is able to shoot his last arrow into Smaug's weak spot, killing him. Smaug falls from the sky, destroying what was left of Lake Town. The news of Smaug's death travels quickly. The Elven King from Mirkwood travels to Lake Town to assist the survivors. The two groups then travel to Lonely Mountain, thinking that the dwarves must have died and the treasure lies unguarded. The Thrush brings the news of Smaug's death and the coming army to the dwarves. The dwarves go back to Lonely Mountain and build a wall to keep the coming army out. Thorin does not believe he should share any of the treasure with the men or elves. Bard and a few elves make their case for Thorin sharing the treasure, but Thorin is not persuaded. So the army puts the mountain under siege. Bilbo, hoping to stop any suffering, puts on the ring and takes the Arkenstone to Bard and the Elf King. He gives the Arkenstone to them in hopes that they can use it to convince Thorin to give in, since Thorin desires the Arkenstone in particular so strongly. While heading back to the mountain, Bilbo finds Gandalf, who has returned from his other affairs. Bard and two messengers return to talk to Thorin. He reveals that he has the Arkenstone, and Bilbo reveals that he was the one that gave the Arkenstone to Bard. Thorin becomes enraged and almost attacks Bilbo, but one of the messengers removes his cloak, revealing that he is Gandalf. Gandalf orders Thorin to stop and let Bilbo explain. Bilbo explains that he took the Arkenstone as his share of the treasure as part of their contract. Thorin agrees to give 1/14 of the treasure to the men and elves in exchange for the Arkenstone. Thorin, however, knows that his cousin Dane is coming with an army, and hopes the dwarf army will be able to regain the Arkenstone. When the dwarf army arrives, they threaten the army of men and elves. But nightfall comes, and Gandalf warns that an army made of goblins and wargs is coming. So the dwarves join with the men and elves to fight against the goblins and the wargs in the Battle of the Five Armies. Bilbo, not wishing to fight, retreats from the battle thanks to his ring. The goblins are winning when Bilbo notices that the eagles are coming to join the fight. A stone falls and hits Bilbo, and he falls unconscious. When Bilbo wakes up, he finds that his side has won the battle. He takes off the ring, and a man finds him and brings him back to camp to meet Gandalf. Gandalf is happy to see Bilbo, but informs him that Thorin has been mortally wounded. Bilbo goes to Thorin, who apologizes for earlier, and the two part as friends. Bilbo also finds out that Filly and Kili died during the battle. Gandalf describes what happened after Bilbo passed out. The eagles helped turn the tide, but Beorn came, and that is what scattered the goblins, who all either died or are in hiding. The dead are buried, and Dane is named the new king under the mountain. Bard becomes the new master of Lake Town, and the dwarves are at peace with the elves. Bard gives Bilbo a share of the treasure. Bilbo, Gandalf, and Beorn head the long way around Mirkwood, spending the winter at Beorn's house. Gandalf and Bilbo then head to Rivendell. It is there that Gandalf reveals what he was doing when he left the dwarves. He fought alongside the Council of Wizards against the Necromancer, an evil force in the south of Mirkwood. Bilbo and Gandalf then return to Bag End, where Bilbo finds that the other hobbits thought he had died and all his possessions were being put on auction. Bilbo is able to recover most of his possessions, but his adventure has isolated him from his fellow hobbits. Nonetheless, Bilbo is happy. That is the plot of The Hobbit. The novel itself proved to stand the test of time and became a classic of literature, particularly children's literature. While the novel itself is worthy of attention and praise, the true reason that we are talking about it at this time will be made very apparent in our next video. That will do it for the story of The Hobbit for now. My name is ballerscuba. This has been Video Games Over Time. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in our next video when we take the story into our own hands. Thank you.